jams. Welcome to 5 Watt World. We're interested in helping get the most music from the least gear. 21-year-old Eric Clapton was not keen on having his picture taken. Though already a fixture on the British music scene for several years from his stint in the Yardbirds, he remained dismissive of the marketing side of being a musician. Maybe he was a bit too caught up in trying to channel the true deep soul of authentic Chicago blues he was so admired. And so on the day the cover photo for the newly recorded John Mayall and the Bluesbreakers with Eric Clapton was being shot, we find a particularly uncooperative young guitar player reading the Beano comic newspaper during the shoot. For this reason, it would be forever casually and affectionately referred to by fans as the Beano album. My interest in this project started with an email from a member of 5 Watt World asking me to recommend a lower wattage replacement for his beloved reissue Marshall Bluesbreaker amp that he'd had since the mid-90s. It set me to thinking. I started by talking with David Barber from Barber Electronics, one of the earliest boutique pedal builders from back before the craze hit. But the more we talked, the deeper down the rabbit hole I slid, until I found myself with so much material that it began to feel like a short history video. So here we go. It may be a bit of an experiment, but grab your Les Paul, grow out your sideburns to a preposterous length, and put your copy of John Mayall and the Bluesbreakers with Eric Clapton on, because this is the 5 Watt World short history of the Beano album. If you enjoy our videos, take a minute to subscribe and hit the bell icon to be notified when we put out new videos. And if you've already subscribed, swing by the store to grab a t-shirt or a hoodie to support what we're doing here. There's a link in the description. By the mid-1960s, the early British flag waivers for Chicago blues had all gone off in different directions. Alex Korner, who had convinced John Mayall to move to London to try his luck there in 1963, had moved in a jazzier direction. Cyril Davies had died tragically in January of 64. And other blues-inspired acts like the Rolling Stones, the Yardbirds, and the Pretty Things had gone in more of the Chuck Berry, Bo Diddley R&B route to court success in hit singles. Still, by 64, Mayall had secured a deal with Decca Records and had recorded two singles, Crawling Up a Hill and Crocodile Walk. Both made about as much progress on the charts as when skating uphill. There was also a live album from December of 64. John Mayall plays John Mayall, recorded at the Klook's Kleek Jazz and Blues Club right next door to the Decca Studios in West Hempstead in North London. Different title, same results. And Decca unceremoniously dropped Mayall. With limited success in the charts, Mayall felt he lacked the lead guitar player that could pull off the energy that he so desired for his band. He wanted someone that could light up the room like Freddie or Albert King. In March of 65, the band was out on tour backing T-Bone Walker up in Nottingham. Story has it that he pulled his rhythm section of John McVie and Hugh Flint around the jukebox and told them to listen to this. The this in question was Eric Clapton playing his solo on Got to Hurry, the B-side of the Yardbirds' For Your Love. Clapton had just quit the Yardbirds after their third and most pop-oriented single in March of 1965 to be replaced by Jeff Beck. And the whole Mayall crew was enthusiastic about trying to add Eric's scorching leads to the band. But Clapton proved difficult to persuade. He just left the Yardbirds because he felt he wasn't free to play the Chicago blues that he was so enthusiastic about. Clapton was so skeptical of joining another British blues band, he was actually considering a move to Chicago when Mayall launched the campaign to recruit him. And according to Flint, one day, quote, I got in the van and there he was, end quote. Mayall was very excited, believing that Clapton was the first guitarist in the band to have the indefinable it that he was looking for. This sentiment would prove itself to be a slight understatement. Clapton settled in quickly, moving in with John and Pamela Mayall and their four children, shutting himself away in a bedroom at the top of the house where he did little but listen to Mayall's massive blues collection and practice guitar. The crowds at the Bluesbreaker Club shows now included a significant number of Eric's followers, and it was around this time that the Clapton is God graffiti began appearing around London. Clapton is often described as moody and mercurial during this time, incredibly driven in his search for authentic blues in others and in himself. His relationship with others could swing wildly day to day. In Clapton's autobiography, he wrote of his fame, I was a bit mystified by this, and part of me ran a mile from it. I really didn't want that kind of notoriety. Eventually, it got to him, and he quite literally quit the Bluesbreakers and ran off on the road with a makeshift unit calling themselves the Glands. But drama and tragedy followed the venture, culminating in threats from a club owner in Athens. Clapton took a bit of a runner, even leaving behind a Les Paul and his Marshall combo amplifier. Upon arriving back in England, the first thing he did was borrow money to call Mayall to get his old job back. This was all quite nervy, as he'd also convinced Bluesbreaker drummer Huey Flint to go with him. But Mayall didn't hesitate to rehire Eric, and Huey along with him. The Blues Breakers have been described as being like an old jazz band, with players changing out every month, and Mayall seemed to take it in stride as being part of the price of doing what he wanted to do most. With Clapton back on board, Mayall was hopeful that Decca might give them another go, and so he went back to Mike Vernon at Decca. Vernon ran with the idea, pitching it to the label on the back of Clapton's popularity to Hugh Mendel. Papers were quickly drawn up to make it happen. Before the Decca deal was put to ink, Mike Vernon had an idea to record some tracks for his side project, Purta Records. They recorded Bernard Jenkins and Lonely Years with just Mayall and Clapton together in a room with a single mic. Vernon said of the session, "Lonely Years was the finest effort Eric ever put on record. It just sums up exactly what Eric was about at that time, the real down-home feel." Lonely Years is often included in deluxe reissues of the Beano album. Mayall, Clapton, and the label were keen to try to capture the live sound of the band, and so arrangements were made to tape a set at the Flamingo Club. The band at that time included Jack Bruce on bass, as McVie was on one of his many alcohol-induced breaks. Tragically, the tapes ended up coming out terribly, and the band was moved into the studio to make the record. The Lonely Years session had also given Vernon a chance to be in the studio with the very headstrong Clapton, and this helped when it came to time to make the Beano record. Vernon was concerned about capturing the band, particularly at the volume that they played live. Studios in England had rules, both written and unwritten, about what could and couldn't be done, directly from the technicians in white coats who maintained the equipment, and who had often helped design and build it as well. Vernon said that Gus Dudgeon, the engineer on the date, was also instrumental in the ultimate recording's achievement. Dudgeon had started as a T-boy at Decca and was promoted to sound engineer as he proved he was able to use and repair the finicky tape machines. He'd engineered the Zombies' hit She's Not There in 1964, and in him, Vernon had found his fellow revolutionary. They were in Decca Studio too. Vernon described the setup succinctly. Straight out from the control room window at the back wall was the drum booth, really a space goboed off from about shoulder height. In front of that was John McVie's bass amp, with John sitting to the right, and the organ was off to his right. Vernon said, "We dressed up the vocals with reverb delays and things like that, so bass, organ, drums, that was all fine." If the idea was to capture the sound of the band live, then that meant that Clapton would be playing, in a word, loud. Eric was almost dismissive of trying to capture a real blues performance in the studio at all, so discussions with Clapton began about how his amp would be recorded. Upon returning from the trip to Greece, Eric had gone straight to Jim Marshall's shop and arranged to buy a new combo on timed payments. Eric's JTM 45 2x12 second generation Marshall combo was turned towards the wall and angled slightly towards the control room. The amp would have been running KT66 power tubes, and since it was turned up so high, the particular flavor of the power tubes would certainly be in play here. I had an enlightening conversation with Dave Honorato from Dojo Guitar in Atlanta on this. Over the years, he's owned both first and second generation 60s Marshall combos. He said that the 66s have more bottom than EL34s. They also have more bell-like top end, though not what we might think of from 6L6 tubes. With turned-up 66s, Dave thought it was reasonable to describe them as being somewhere between 34s and 6L6s, with some of the good characteristics of each. The amp was likely loaded with two early 20-watt Celestion Alnicos. The speakers use that Alnico magnet, and that is critical to the smooth mid-range and slight British chime coming from the amp. And that just leaves the debate about whether Eric Clapton used a Dallas Rangemaster treble booster on the date. There's not much evidence for the theory. I spoke with Dave Honorato and David Barber. Neither think that what we're hearing on the record is indicative of the tone you'd get with a treble booster circuit at volume. Barber said he's researched this high and low, and he believes that this theory started appearing in the late 1990s, and not before. Perhaps, not so coincidentally, around the same time that some recreation Rangemasters were being marketed. In his autobiography, Clapton said he wanted to get the stinging sound that Freddie King got with his Les Paul. Of course, Freddie's guitar was a gold top with P90s, quite a different animal from the 1960-ish burst Les Paul Standard with uncovered PAF pickups that Eric was playing. The guitar would be stolen from Cream's rehearsal studio just a few short months after the record was completed. Clapton said in his autobiography that he'd put it on the bridge pickup and turned the bass on the amp all the way up, fattening up the sound. Eric stood to the right, next to the amp. Clapton said that he insisted on the mic placement being slightly further away from his amplifier. He said he wanted to play through it and get the sound that he got on stage, with the amp on full and the guitar on full, riding the distortion and the feedback. As Vernon said, they turned the amp towards the wall, then put half-height gobos all around it, put the mic about 2 feet from the amp, and covered the whole thing with a huge blanket to try to contain the sound. But the guitar, of course, was bleeding into everything. They recorded live onto 4-track, but Vernon said you could hear the guitar in the drums and in the vocals, frankly, everywhere. And in the end, they had Mayall do some of the vocals over again. And there's clearly second guitar parts laid in on some of the tracks, and that must have been overdubs after Bounce Down as well. It's often said that Clapton's tone in this record became the template for all blues rock that came after. A Les Paul into a Marshall certainly became the preferred kit for many after its release. But it left me wondering what the rest of the band was playing on the date. Few people seemed to talk about that. John McVie was certainly playing either his Fender Precision or his Fender Jazz Bass. And the only photos we have are of him with the Precision, so that seems most likely. This specific bass would go on to be his main P bass in Fleetwood Mac. It'd eventually strip off the burst finish, and it would take on a walnut hue from sweat, smoke, and mileage. The amp used is harder to figure out, so I put the question to the good folks on the TalkBass forum. One guess supported by this photo is a Vox rig, an AC50, likely with some sort of an extension cab, something very similar to Paul McCartney's early bass rig. But then another forum member, someone who had regularly seen McVie with Mayall lineups that included both Clapton and Peter Green, said that he'd only ever seen McVie playing a Marshall Super 100 head into a 412 cab during that time. This is certainly possible, as Jim Marshall and company had built the very first 45-100 amps at the request of Pete Townsend in the middle of 1965. Drummer Huey Flint is often associated with playing a four-piece set of Premier drums during this time. Premier drums were made in London starting in the early 1920s. Here's a pic of Flint behind a Premier kit with the Clapton iteration of the Blues Breakers. So though he may have later been known for playing a set of Black Ludwig Keystones, I think all Mahogany-era Premiers are the best guess here. Huey was really as much a jazz drummer as anything, and he was said not to really hit the drums that hard, even with this band. As an aside, Huey was supposedly a bit miffed on the session because Mike Vernon had asked him to try to avoid hitting his crash cymbal while playing. There's a picture on the back of the Beano album showing the back of Mayall's organ facing into the room. We know it's Mayall's own instrument because his name is prominently painted across the side that would generally face the audience when performing. He likely used the upright piano that was there in the studio and was well known for his bandolier of harmonicas strapped around his waist or across his chest. The brass parts were added after the initial recordings were done, played by Alan Skidmore, Johnny Allman, and Dennis Healy. The blues purists were very critical of this addition, and though Mayall was dismissive of these complaints, by his next record, Hard Road, he put in the liner notes that he had no plans to add horns to the Blues Breakers in the future, except here and there in the studio. According to Mike Vernon, once they started playing, the levels were immediately a concern. Gus Dudgeon was saying, "We can't do this, man. We can't do it. We're not allowed." There were people in the cafe behind the studio complaining about the noise. At typical recording volumes, they would never have heard it, but the band was bleeding through the entire studio complex. Gus said, "People were coming down to the studio to see what was going on." A factor in the sound of the album, and no doubt a contributing factor to the specific sound of each instrument, is the vintage recording gear itself. Decca was one of the early kings of the recording game, with a sterling reputation in both popular and classical music. They often had designed and built their own equipment to remain at the cutting edge of recording technology. In 1966, Decca Studio 2 had just this sort of custom-built console. The preamps were tube-driven, as no doubt were the limiters and EQs in the room as well, all feeding a 4-track Studer J37 tape machine. Modern recording gear companies rightly preach about the quality that transformers in the signal path add, and there would have been many of these in the path as well in 1966. On those days in the studio, the console was being hit with a volume that, if not beyond spec, was certainly beyond the experience of Dudgeon and Vernon. This should be part of any conversation about chasing Clapton's guitar tone from this record. The recording gear had at least as much to do with what ended up on the tape as the specifics of the guitar and the tubes in the amp. David Barber has spent decades reading and thinking about this challenge and trying to create the sound of Clapton's guitar parts. In the end, he worked with me throughout the research on the project, providing many of the best references. He reminded me that Clapton's tone is often described as all bridge pickup and dry, and upon closer inspection, you realize it's neither. There's a fullness to the bridge tones, and clearly he seems to be mixing both pickups at times. Though there was little written about the recording technique specific to the Mayall date, there was an excellent article from Sound on Sound magazine in 2009 detailing that same studio when the Moody Blues recorded their seminal Days of Future Past in 1967. Decca had custom echo chambers built on the roof of the building, and there were 4 EMT plate reverbs in the basement, both of which could be tied in during recording or after and added in the final mix. There were four EMT plates because each plate was mono and needed to be added to an individual track. According to Vernon, they used chambers on the vocal during the recording to give the band a good live feel, but they had to be careful to not overdo it, resulting in too much reverb in the initial recording passes. Vernon said that they might have done more planning about the material, but in the end, Mayall and the band made all the choices. Mostly, they were drawing from the tunes that the band had been playing live, and that had done well in the clubs. Mayall wanted to do Mose Allison's Parcham Farm, and Ray Charles' What'd I Say to feature the organ. The second tune was specifically selected to give Huey Flint a drum solo moment, something that didn't really excite Huey, but he went along. Pay attention after the drum solo, and you'll hear Clapton quoting the Beatles' Day Tripper. It always gives me a smile no matter how many times I hear it. Eric never tried to hide his influences, often mercilessly comparing himself to them and seeing only his own faults. Double Crossing Time had originally been written by Eric and John when Jack Bruce jumped ship to go work with Manfred Mann. The original title was actually Double Crossing Man, but it was later changed to Double Crossing Time. Clapton's solo on this tune was dubbed in later during the recording of the album, and you can clearly hear two guitar parts on the tune. The guitar tone on Key to Love is so very bright that it makes you wonder whether he's got his tone rolled off slightly during much of the rest of the other tunes. It's also notable that Clapton was one of the first to make use of the top-of-the-line Centrolab potentiometers in his Les Pauls. On the tune Steppin' Out, the guitar tone is drier again, and feels like maybe the middle pickup position for Eric. There's less bite, but not quite all the way to a neck pickup sound. This is one of the most powerful tone-shaping features of Les Pauls, and something we very much miss on humbucking guitars with just one volume. On It Ain't Right, it feels clearly like the bridge pickup, but there's decidedly less gain running. Conspicuously absent from their live set had been Robert Johnson's Ramblin' on My Mind, Clapton's debut effort on vocals here. He'd sung with the Yardbirds, but had not had to carry the whole band out front. Clapton was reluctant, but Mayall encouraged him. It all worked out well in the end, but it's somewhat ironic that by encouraging Clapton, Mayall accelerated Clapton's plan to leave to go front a blues trio of his own. He'd been musing on the idea ever since seeing Buddy Guy with his trio, the sheer space and power of the format deeply appealing to him. According to Dudgeon, it took just 4 days to collect all the parts they needed to complete the album. Released on July 22, 1966, the album proved to be the breakthrough record that Mayall had been desperate for. It went to number 6 on the UK album charts on July 30th, but Clapton had already quit the Blues Breakers prior to the album's release to put together Cream with Ginger Baker and Jack Bruce. Peter Green, who'd been in the band while Clapton was off in Greece with the Glands, came back to the Blues Breakers to replace Clapton and found himself playing in the wake of that success. Given the nearly identical setups and bands, playing the two records back-to-back is a natural lesson in how much the individual guitar player matters to the sound and feel of a record. An interesting aside is that the first gig for Cream, before they'd even had a name for the band yet, was at the Windsor Jazz and Blues Festival on July 31, 1966. That festival was a veritable who's who of the rock and blues scene, including The Who. And just above Eric Clapton's name on the poster, there's a band, Bluesology, listed. That group included a young keyboardist named Reginald Dwight, who we'd all later come to know as Elton John. Beano was released in stereo in the UK in December of 1969. Throughout the years, it's been reissued a number of times, as have been individual tracks from the album. No self-respecting blues fan, nor student of modern blues or rock guitar should be without a copy. I realized I spent a lot of time talking about the gear used to make this record in the video, but of course, it wasn't the gear that they played, but rather the notes that they played together that mattered. I'm a big fan of Robin Ford, so I chased his tone for years. I bought a Zen Drive, ran it into a Blackface Fender amp, and at that time I joked that I could sound exactly like Robin, until I played the second note. So if you really want to try to sound like Clapton, go do some homework. From personal experience, I can recommend Jeff McAlane's course, British Blues, on the Truefire site. You'll get closer to that Beano sound faster than if you spend time lusting after that perfect Bluesbreaker copy amp. I guarantee it. I need to thank Harry Shapiro for his excellent article, John Mayall's Bluesbreakers with Eric Clapton, The Making of the Beano Album, on loudersound.com. Thanks to the guys on the drum forum for the help in digging up what Huey Flint was playing on those 4 days. Also, thanks to the good people on the TalkBase forum, particularly Chris, who'd seen Clapton perform with Mayall so many times back in the day. David Barber was a partner in crime on this one, and I owe much of the research to his lifelong fascination with tone, in general, and with the Beano album, in particular. As always, I'm indebted to Perry McManus for taking a break from describing the universe mathematically to edit the script in simple, yet ever elegant English. I need to thank Dave Honorato from Dojo Guitar Repair. I've given up being surprised when Dave says, well, I've owned both those amps. His firsthand experience is priceless, and if you're not following him on Instagram already, I encourage you to do so. And I need to thank Jeff Mackerling for providing the intro and outro music for the video. He's one of those rare guys that's a great player who's also a great teacher. I highly recommend his new album, titled Now, produced by Robin Ford. You shouldn't miss his style of the blues, via Chicago, via London, via Brooklyn. If I missed something, or if you have your own Beano story to share, please put it in the comments for everyone to enjoy. If you enjoyed the short history of the Beano album, hit the like button, and if you haven't subscribed yet, go ahead and hit that too. Remember to click the bell icon to be notified when we put out a new video. And if you want to support these videos even more, stop by the store and grab a t-shirt or a mug. The link's at the top of the description. Thanks for watching. Until next time, thanks for being a part of the 5-Watt World.